Okay, it's 10:02, so we'll go ahead and get started. 10:02 here in the Pacific Northwest. I'm Lucy Savitz. I am the director at the Center for Health Research and Vice President for Health Research here in Kaiser Permanente's Northwest region. And it's my honor and pleasure to co-lead the Learning Health System Interest Group for Academy Health with Dr. Hal Luft. And today we're bringing you an important presentation by Dr. Jodyn Platt on navigating ethical challenges for embedded research in learning health systems. This webinar not only is important in its content, and I think will be informative for everybody, it also launches a learning health system challenge that will be announced at the very end of this presentation. So following the Q&A, please stay tuned and we'll highlight the requirements for the contest and how the contest will be executed and what that all means. So hopefully that's a teaser to keep you engaged. I'm sure everybody on this call is an expert at using Zoom at this point, but just a couple of reminders. One is we're recording this particular webinar. Obviously we're working across time zones and people are busy, so we wanna be sure that everybody who wants to hear from Dr. Platt has the opportunity to do that. So this session is currently being recorded. There were two ways to interact. One is if you have questions for Dr. Platt, there's a Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. You can enter your questions at any time during the presentation, and we'll get to as many of those as possible during the Q&A portion. Also, Dr. Platt really enjoys hearing from the audience during her presentation. And if you have comments, and there'll be certain points in the presentation where she'll request that you chat in. The chat button is a different button, but it's at the bottom of your screen as well. So during her presentation, as you interact at those various points in time, that's the button to use. We're really happy to have Dr. Platt with us today. And without further ado, I'm going to turn it over. Jodyn, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me. I'm very excited to be here and to eventually, hopefully, talk with all of you after we finish. I'm going to pull up my slides. Hold on. Sorry, I went out of order. Oh, I need to be able to share my slides.
Okay, you should be able to. Let me know if you have an issue.
All right, how does that look?
Good? Looks good.
Okay. So, so as Dr. Savitz mentioned, I'm gonna talk to you about the sort of ethical challenges for LHS embedded research. And, you know, ethics is a process of raising questions, and I hope to raise a few, but also maybe point to a few areas for solutions and inquiry and what can we sort of do with the ethical challenge that this type of work raises. So the key points that I'd like, you know, if you, you know, stop listening today or a minute right now to come home with the idea that LHS embedded research is important, but we need sort of dynamic systems for disclosure and engagement. And then we certainly need robust monitoring and review of risks and outcomes because those kinds of systems don't currently exist in any sort of systematic way. So as mentioned earlier, we're gonna have some questions in the chat. I thought I'd start with a really easy one. Where are you sort of calling in from today? The questions will not get any easier than this. So if you're gonna put something in the chat, now would be the time. We mentioned there's at least three time zones here. And so starting again with this question of what is LHS embedded research? And I think the best way to describe this is perhaps by example. So here is a problem at health system A where they have low completion rates for diabetic retinal screening, presumably because it involves an extra visit to a specialist, bright lights, it's not very comfortable, pupil dilation, which means people need a sort of help for completing that visit. So there's a potential solution and sort of a new technology, a special kind of camera that can be used by a non-specialist. It doesn't require dilation, but obviously buying lots of cameras for lots of diabetic patients in this health system may be quite expensive. And so Health System A sort of sits and asks itself, should we buy new cameras? And if so, how many? And so what they do is they decide to buy one camera or two, and they randomize between these two clinically acceptable treatments. And then they can evaluate and publish the results. They assess their completion rates. They can do subpopulation analyses, evaluate patient satisfaction, disease burden, and come up with a solution. So this is a fairly low-hanging fruit in sort of the area of LHS embedded research. We're taking two clinically acceptable options, we're evaluating them systematically, and we're implementing a change and then monitoring that change. And so ideally, there's a whole sort of slew of questions out there that can essentially replace what's now a haphazard process with one that is deliberately random and that we can learn from. And we're basically learning from the system and providing a treatment that is no worse. Randomization in and of itself is not sort of an introduction of risk. But these activities, most learning health LHS embedded research is not systematically subject to oversight or regulation. Some of these studies, like the one we just described, is not necessarily federally funded research. So things like the common rule and informed consent don't sort of automatically kick in. It may fall under quality improvement kinds of things, which again is sort of a different set of rules, which doesn't have the same kind of oversight that research does. So IRBs may be able to pick up on some of this oversight capacity, but it depends on sort of local capacity of IRBs. Health system leadership can also sort of pick up some of the oversight functions, assuming political will and appropriate benchmarks are known. Certainly, you know, I said informed consent may not apply. Should it apply? Again, it's a question. I think for a lot of LHS embedded research, it may not apply because it's sort of, so it's not required, but it's also very difficult in the context of big data, biobanks, dynamic modeling systems, where you've already sort of collected the data and you're coming up with research questions post hoc. And so informed consent has generally been a model and a process where we can describe future risks and benefits to patients. We can describe how the data is going to be used. We can say who's going to be using it. And in the LHS embedded research context, it's really hard to say exactly what you're going to be using information for and what kinds of studies you'll do and who's going to be using it. And it's sort of a one-time thing. And ideally, LHS embedded research is an ongoing activity of a health system. Which leaves us with disclosure and notification, and which is sort of the next best option. So we can certainly, if we can't sort of ask for permission up front, we can let people know. And I'll show some research that we have that's ongoing and is sort of part of, sort of begins to tell a consistent story that people want to know, and they want to have sort of simple and accessible ways of knowing what's going on in a given health system. So this is a study we're currently writing up where we did a survey of the US population, a nationally representative survey of a little over 2000 people. And we asked them how true was this set of statements about whether they would like to be notified about university researchers, quality analysts, commercial companies using their identified or de-identified health information or biospecimens. So you can imagine there's 12 different combinations of how these questions were asked. And here they are. And you can see they answered on a scale from 1 to 4. For all of these different combinations, they all fall on the side of yes, please notify me. There are a few other things that I think are interesting about these data. One is that you can see the sort of peaks here are for issues of identified biospecimens and health information versus de-identified. So there's a stronger preference for notification for identified data, which isn't surprising. But things that may be sort of interesting and surprising here are that there isn't a huge differentiation between, say, health information and biospecimens. So people are sort of thinking about those kinds of things perhaps in similar ways. They're also not making a strong distinction between university researchers and quality analysts, which basically puts the LHS embedded researcher or quality analyst, or sort of however you personally identify in this realm of please notify your patients about what's being done with their data. So we've also done some research into how people would like to be notified. And this is, again, sort of some work that's just finishing up right now. We did 6 deliberations across the state of Michigan and ended up talking to about 136 people, both virtually and in person. This was ended up being a hybrid COVID study, but we talked to people about how they would want to know if they want to know how health systems share their data for precision health, which is sort of which is learning health system activity. So we offered 4 different options in what I'm describing right now. We said, would you like to have sort of signs and sort of places that say, you know, clearly we're using your health information for research, for learning, and if you want to know more, you can, you know, can call this number. We offered a second option was to be able to text message people or email them and sort of have an active role in pushing messages forward. We asked about whether people wanted to have access to information about how their health information is shared via their patient portal. And then finally, they said we offered, you know, we could just sort of leave things the way they are, which is there is sort of a blanket notification when people sort of enroll at being a patient. And here, again, people sort of prioritized the patient portal as where they would like to be able to receive information about data sharing and about sort of research activities and learning activities in the context of the healthcare system. In sort of uniformly, people, again, want to know, and there may be some variability in how they want to know, but the status quo may not be the optimal option right now. And the kinds of things we heard about the patient portal is that they just want a place to know, you know, I just want to know who's sharing my data, and that disclosure in this way at least honors the dignity of the individual patient. So ultimately, we've talked a little bit, you know, the sort of example that I gave was one of these green activities where there's low risk and high value. There are also going to be high risk and low value activities that hopefully there's some sort of oversight to say, no, let's maybe not prioritize those. But there are also going to be a number of activities that fall into a gray area. And I think the sort of data from patients that we hear is that there should be some level of communication about all of those things. But if we're really looking at things about risk and value, then what do we really mean by risk? And I'd like to sort of run through a few examples of what we might mean by risk. And then we can sort of maybe discuss those a bit. So the first is that, you know, as we're using data to develop, say, predictive models that can be used in healthcare, again, who's monitoring the use and outcomes of those predictive models? And what happens when the models are wrong? So in this particular case, suppose we had data that we used to develop an AI model that ultimately predicts that within your healthcare system, a single parent living in a certain neighborhood with no job, a car, and no stable relationship has a likelihood of 95% to be involved in domestic violence. Is this then, as a caregiver, actionable information? And what happens if the model goes wrong? And I don't have answers for this, but I think it's a good opportunity to sort of think about how do you feel about this kind of a situation? And it sort of rises to the surface the importance of assessing risk, whether that's internal validity, sort of are you making the correct in-house references? Do you have information that's generalizable? Is there external validity to what it is that you're generating? Is there validity over time? And are you applying population level knowledge to individuals? In the case that we just ran through, hopefully that kind of information might trigger a conversation with a provider. And if that's the case, then you know that we can have better outcomes. The second sort of set of risk activities to think about here are the sort of systemic issues and group harms. So we, it's sort of now in the news quite a bit, I think, the sort of the systemic racism is embedded in our data. And these are sort of historical features and facts, really, where sort of history of discrimination leads to histories of lack of access and poor health outcomes. So this is sort of demonstrating the example of redlining, where in the 1930s, we started to sort of label certain neighborhoods as good or bad, which led to disinvestment of certain neighborhoods in New York City, which today we're sort of seeing the health effects of even now. And we see this kind of this sort of systemic racism also embedded in the data-driven sort of tools that we have. If you haven't read this paper, it came out late in 2019. It's a really important, sort of became an instant classic and is a really important one to look at. But what they did was that they showed a systematic bias and an algorithm used to manage the health of populations. And the bias stemmed from the fact that the algorithm was using healthcare cost as a proxy for healthcare need. And as it turns out, we spend a lot less money on the health, on treating Black patients than we do for white patients. And so it underestimated the need in a fairly systematic way of Black patients in a given health services, in a specific healthcare system. So these problems can sort of compound themselves. And again, there's very little transparency around what we have as our tools that come out of the data that we use to conduct the studies and conduct our learning health activities. And so again, one option would be to sort of investigate how can we generate labels for predictive models that describe not only sort of what goes into the model and how it's being used and by whom, but are there questions of equity and inequity that we should sort of have at our sort of immediate awareness and our fingertips as we're using them. And then finally, sort of in terms of the risk calculation and risk sort of understanding risk, there are certainly sort of risks to systems themselves, right? So we're operating in right now in sort of an environment that's fairly volatile relative to other times. We have sort of large policy initiatives that are moving towards increased data sharing and integration across systems in the 21st Century Act, while we also have a relatively robust and rigorous sort of emphasis on privacy rights, whether that's through the California Privacy Law or the European GDPR. We're sort of trying to understand what does it mean to protect dignity and privacy of individuals beyond HIPAA. And then there's sort of the shifting tides of public opinion, where there's mistrust of the tech industry, which may be increasingly involved in the kinds of learning health activities we think we want to do, and that trust in healthcare itself is relatively qualified and may not be the sort of given and a fair assumption that it once was. So this comes to the sort of front pages of the news again, in cases where a health system can be sued and over data sharing and these sort of collaborations that the public doesn't find acceptable. So this was also in 2019 where Google and the University of Chicago were sued over a data sharing project where they were going to use images to sort of generate a large data set that could then sort of help with diagnostics. And it turned out that this lawsuit was ultimately dropped because there was nothing illegal about it. And yet the fact that they were sued in the first place suggests there was some level of unacceptability in the court of sort of public opinion. And so what we have are sort of privacy policy and best practices are not currently lining up very well, which leaves it to us and leaves it to the kinds of challenges that hopefully this interest group can come on and take on to address sort of what should be the best practices for how health information is shared, how it's generated and used in the context of learning health systems, And how do we address sort of the discomfort with certain types of data sharing? We know that re-identification can be easy, especially with linked data sets, which means that when we look, think back to that graph of sort of the comfort with identified versus de-identified data, if all of the data is really closer to the identifiable area, again, notification becomes all that more important. And then we also, I think, need to start thinking a little bit about something called group privacy. And that has to do with sort of the autonomy of somebody to be labeled or not labeled. And again, that sort of requires a certain level of engagement and dialogue with your patient populations. So an example of this, again, was sort of last summer during this, as the Black Lives Movement sort of took off across the country, there were a number of people that were really interested in understanding who was using the hashtag Black Lives Matter or hashtag BLM. And it turned out to be a very difficult group to try to label in that way. And it just sort of raises questions around privacy, around dignity, around how do we, what do we call individuals and who gets to make that decision. And then the final sort of note here is that the privacy solutions in terms of just trying to protect the identity of certain individuals still will not address the concerns about transparency and honesty, but being transparent and honest will help build trust over time. So what do we need to sort of make the embedded learning health system work? Sort of driving some of these points home, we're going to have systems that recognize the high value, low risk, but also the low value and high risk studies. We're going to have simple implementation for learning health systems for those high value, low risk questions. We don't want to impose barriers where there need not be any, but we want to make sure that the appropriate guide rails are in place. We'll need systems that evaluate the internal external validity of studies and findings, but while also checking for inequity. And then active disclosure of learning health activities, and then these sort of dynamic systems that can adapt to changes over time. So how do we sort of do those things? So I think there are really sort of three things, and I'm gonna sort of describe these in two different ways, but we need to look, right? So we need these oversight structures that may or may not currently exist. So we either create new structures or we leverage existing structures that can track and evaluate the use, implementation, and impact with the goal of minimizing bias and maximizing learning and really checking in. Are we really sort of measuring and evaluating what we think we are? We need to listen and sort of engage in that disclosure activity, but not one that is just simply a disclosure practice, but the one that generates dialogue. And the aim here is to sort of make sure that we're facing the ways in which the digital world ultimately mirrors the challenges, biases, and inequity of the three-dimensional world. And then finally, to create sort of new systems. And again, I put up a couple of sort of options in this presentation in terms of how we can engage in the questions of notification and permission. But I think there's a lot of work that still needs to be done here. So what do we need and what can we do that really honors autonomy and respects patient wishes? So in terms of policy priorities, we need, again, these systems that prevent high value, high risk, low value, that prioritize low risk, high value systems and policy that really sort of articulate who's risk and who's value, and then where do we provide the sort of disclosure notification for all activities. So now the real question is, can we do this? And my hope is that I think we can, and maybe through some of the challenges and solutions that you guys come up with in your interest group, we'll get there. So thank you. I think we're ready for questions.
Great. Thank you very much, Jody. And I neglected to just in my introductory comments, since I think I know Jody and I've had the opportunity of working with her over the years. Dr. Platt is from the University of Michigan in the Learning Health System Department. And that's where she spearheaded a lot of this work. So thanks for this really great presentation. We have a number of questions that have come in. I'm gonna start with one that was entered in the chat and then I'll go to the Q&A. Informed consent often provides a mechanism for study participants to learn the findings of the research. Do LHS researchers have an obligation to share their findings in a similar way? What do you think about that?
So I think that yes, there is an obligation to give back results, but again, it's not a requirement, right? And so I think we need to make, if it is important, we need to make it a standard practice.
Mm-hmm. And I would say too, Jody, when we think back to the survey that you completed across the country with NRC, there are two questions that came up. One is, did you define quality analysts for respondents in the survey? And just wondering whether or not or how people drew distinctions between different flavors of researchers and analysts.
Yeah, so we defined both quality analysts and researcher. I don't remember the specific definitions, but we provided the definitions. And then they were able to sort of review the definitions as they went through all of the different questions. So I think it's a fair question in terms of how people differentiate it. Mm-hmm. But it's also, I think, a really important one because our policies treat those two activities as so fundamentally different.
Right.
But I do think that among the general public, it's not as clear. And we've done other surveys that sort of indicate the same thing, that people aren't differentiating between quality and research.
Right. And I'm not sure the timing of when you did the survey, but did you notice any changes in patients' views in the survey before and during COVID?
Yeah, so this was done in 2019 before COVID, and we actually have another survey that we just did in October of this year. We have the data is coming in 6 days. So we'll be able to evaluate some of that change over time.
But stay tuned to learn more about that. And here's sort of a more general question from a bioethics standpoint. A worry bead for me is the cursory statement of consent and general authorization contained in care forms in hospitals and health systems, indicating that the data may be used for research.
Yep.
As a minor sort of bullet or paragraph in teeny tiny print, and it's usually signed at the time of admission or service in the facility, and it assumes or presumes that there's a responsibility of the system in meeting the privacy consent permission standards. And what are the ideas about better processes or standards or genuine trust building practices that the health systems themselves should be engaged in?
I mean, I think the general consensus is, well, at least in my mind, is that they should be doing all of those things. I think it can be very difficult because there's a sort of a natural tension between what we have to do and what we should do. And, you know, how do we invest limited resources? But I think that what we hear from the community and from patients is that they really would like this kind of investment, that we can sort of develop a patient portal that may be way more informative than it is now. We should, you know, understand sort of what the standards are and should be. Maybe we give people choice about how often they consent or re-informed about how their health information is being shared. These are all, I mean, they're empirical questions, they're open, they're far from, I think, established.
Great, thanks. Mm-hmm. And just a basic question in your opinion, and this is sort of a big one here, Jody.
Okay.
is there an ethical responsibility for systems to learn and improve?
Yes. I mean, sure. Yes. I mean, I think, yeah. I mean, there's the healthcare system is supposed to be taking care of us. And so I would hope that they can take care of them, you know, that they know that they're doing that and they can demonstrate how they're doing it.
Yeah. I worked with Brent James at Intermountain Healthcare for 12 years, and what I've heard him say repeatedly over the years is that it's a definitive yes. And,
yeah.
You know, it there's a basic presumption that we are providing the best possible care at all times. Without learning and constantly improving, you're not living up to your ethical obligation to provide that best quality care. Let's go back to the questions now. How do you join traditional research clinical approaches like launching an intervention and waiting for a period of time to assess the outcomes within an LHS model approach where there's a need for regular data extracts to improve the care delivery in real time? And are there ethical implications to this?
Yes, I mean, I think that there's, and you can help me answer this question, but because I think there's a fairly broad range of what could count as LHS research activity or investigation. Mm-hmm. And it can be sort of quick sort of data extraction, like analysis, and then we sort of do something and evaluate it versus a long-term kind of study where the question may be a little more nuanced or we just need a different method to answer the question that we're trying to learn about, right? And I think that's where the sort of my push for the oversight functions would come in, right? Because if it is a more complicated learning health activity, there certainly should be, we should do it, but there should also be maybe a different level of oversight if it's higher risk or longer term or whatever it is, but somebody should know what's going on in the system.
Right, and I think this question also speaks to the tension. I'd be interested if you agree or not. This tension between the operational needs for more near-term decision making, mm-hmm. versus the length of time when you bring the rigors of research to those problems, mm-hmm. that the operations are facing, mm-hmm. and so sometimes maybe the challenge is how can we structure our design and methods in a way that we can provide interim milestone results that right. can help sort of bridge that gap.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I think that's right.
Great. How do you explain, you come from the Learning Health System Department, which according to Chuck Fried is the only Learning Health System Department in the United States, maybe the world. How do you explain learning health system science to laypersons?
That's a great
question. No pressure, Jody.
It's a really great question. I'm sort of laughing because, I feel like I've tried to explain it to my parents and I'm still not sure they know what I do, but I think, so learning health system science is, the goal of learning health system science is to improve systems of care and the health of people and populations. We do that by sort of coming up with a set of questions that we think we can answer, collecting the data to answer that, generating new knowledge and testing to see whether or not we've accomplished that goal. I don't know if that's clear enough for a layperson, but that would maybe where I start. And then I sort of.
Great, thank you.
How confused they are.
Uh-huh. I'm going to go back to the questions and shift direction a little bit. So this may be a little more straightforward to answer. The emphasis of your talk was on patients as participants. Can you talk about parallel challenges of consent and disclosure with clinicians and staff or employees who are viewed by IRBs as high-risk research populations?
So is this question about whether when the providers are the research,
yes.
research subjects?
Mm-hmm.
I think what everything I've described still holds in terms of having different, providers as sub research subjects. I think in general, one of the challenges around learning health system activities and learning in general is that it's an inherently vulnerable process. And so when you're talking to, say, providers and you're saying, okay, we're going to study your behavior and your outcomes, it can be seen perhaps as a threat to either professional autonomy, personal integrity. And so it's sort of incumbent, I would say, on the researcher, the person or the system that's trying to generate the new knowledge with those as research subjects to say, you know, it's, we're going to be doing this so that we can learn, so we can make systems better. It's not about, you know, whether you get to keep your job or not keep your job.
Mm-hmm. Great, thanks. You know, I've noticed that Francis Chesley from AHRQ is on listening in. I know we have a number of people who are participating from the LHS K-12 programs. And this is a relevant question, I think, especially for them, but for everybody on the call from Hal Loft. How might we use far better training and ethics to using data, asking questions, and presenting results to be able to rely more on those who are doing the work rather than just setting hard rules versus analogs to IRBs? Hal says, for example, nurses and others in clinical settings see and know about people who aren't their own patients. They haven't given specific consent, for example, yet are ethically required to deal with that information as confidential.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so again, this is sort of about training.
Right.
Training. I mean, I think we need a lot. I think we need two brands of training, right? There's the training of sort of existing practitioners and trainees and people who haven't even sort of started the field yet. And there, again, I think you've picked up on there's sort of two ways of sort of teaching and understanding ethics. There's sort of the rule-based ethics and the procedural kinds of things, which again, people should know. But it's also, I think, especially in learning health systems, when we're talking about data and information and things that ethics really hasn't necessarily sort of taken up yet in the same kind of way. And so there's that sort of piece of it. But I also think, you know, there's a huge role of sort of educating health system leaders and, you know, trying to find ways for them to sort of pick up what we know may be sort of the ethically right thing to do and incentivize, you know, redesign of patient portals or mechanisms of disclosure to patients and providers and others. So I think it's a multi-faceted kind of training activity, both about what sort of is, but also what should be and what can't, you know, what we can do about it.
Mm-hmm. Are you aware of any training like this?
No. No, and in fact, I mean, part of, I think, you know, when I first started in the learning health system, you know, department, it was like, oh yeah, well, we can do X, Y, Z with patient portal, da, da, da. And I remember somebody saying to me, well, what's the return on investment of redesigning the patient portal? Like, that's not where this new EHR is gonna, you know, it's not where we're gonna spend our money. And that may have been an N of one kind of experience, but it sort of resonated sort of throughout that unless it's not necessarily a priority. I mean, it was also a long time ago, and I think, you know, we may be ready for it now, where, you know, 10 years ago we were not.
Mm-hmm. Great. One final question. I wonder if anyone has asked patients how they feel about not being included in quality of care or quality improvement, and separately not being offered the chance to participate in research studies.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot more to be asked in that area. We've done a little bit of asking. And I think, you know, for some people, having the autonomy and the right to opt out is really important. And they don't quite see the benefit. So there's the disclosure, like, we're going to do all of this stuff. There's also the disclosure of, here's how we've benefited you and people like you and our health system from the learning health activities that we've done. So there's sort of both types of disclosure that I think need to happen.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And just so you know, and I'm trying to watch the chat and the Q&A simultaneously.
I know you're doing great.
We're seeing a lot of agreement in the chat about bringing senior leaders into these ethical discussions is really key and important as we're moving forward. And we do have one other question that just came in. In Minnesota, health systems are required to ask patients for permission to use their data for research, and patients have an opportunity to opt out of providing their data for research. It does not apply to QI. In practice, fewer than 10% of patients actually opt out of providing their data. Does providing patients an opportunity to opt out in this way outweigh the potential decrease in knowledge generation from a less representative sample? And is this something that other health systems should be instituting if they aren't required to do so?
A great question. I mean, I think that's a nice anecdote to the other, you know, that was out there. You know, again, if I think it's really important to know what's going on with that 10% of people, and what are you missing?
Yeah, reflecting back on the earlier comment that we had, as the worry beat around this issue, and sort of the, you know, when people sort of check in for their service, they, you know, sort of maybe, you know, don't even realize that they're agreeing that their data gets to be used for research, right? That general blanket acceptance may be different than if it was a particular study.
Right, yeah.
And people don't have the chance to opt out. And you can think of, you know, for religious reasons, for example, or other kinds of concerns that people may have about when and if they want. And you know, a lot of times, I don't know if you've seen some of the newer technologies, like Apple has a technology for consenting. And instead of, you know, an overall, you know, consent form where you're agreeing to participate fully in a study, you can say, well, I'll participate in this part, but not that part. And it seems like we're, you know, these documents have become these legalese documents. People often don't even know what they're agreeing to and don't have the ability to fully have informed consent.
Yeah, no, it's absolutely true. And I think we can do better, right? If Apple can do better, so can we.
Well, that's a broad statement. If Apple can do better, so can we. And I see Sarah has entered into the chat some other companies that are very forward thinking in this particular area. Well, Jody, I just want to thank you so much on behalf of everybody who's had the chance to listen in today. And it's been very thought-provoking for us to think about the sort of ethical challenges. I'm going to switch now to the Learning Health System Challenge Contest that we want to let everybody know about. So thank you. This, again, was recorded, and we'll send out the link to folks so that they'll have a chance to hear more from you if they were not able to attend today. But the Learning Health System Interest Group is an active interest group as a part of Academy Health. And what we're interested in doing is capturing experiences and conducting embedded research in real-world learning health systems. So if we could go to the next slide, please, John. What's this all about? We are instituting the contest so that we can understand some of the challenges people are experiencing in conducting their embedded research in real world. And what solutions or strategies did you use in overcoming these? There is a template for submitting your examples. It's due January 21st. And of the submitted examples, 10 will be selected to be presented at the Academy Health Arm, which will be held June 4th through 7th in 2022. They will be published in the Learning Health System Journal, and Dr. Chuck Fried is the senior editor of that journal. And there will be a $1,000 stipend to those 10 individuals to support their attendance, either their meeting registration, their annual membership dues to Academy Health, and or travel expenses to attend the meeting. If you do have questions about this, you can email us at lhs_ig@kpchr.org. And right now, if you would like to receive the template for submission with all of the instructions, if you send a message, and the message should read KPCHR to the number 22828, so the number you're sending this to is 22828. You're sending a text message, and the message code is KPCHR. It is not case sensitive. You'll be prompted with a request for your email address, and the response will automatically come and provide you with the PDF session so that you can understand what's required to submit by January 21st. We really, really are excited to hear from people and understand what people are experiencing in the real world. And it's an opportunity for us to learn together. You know, a lot of us are experiencing these issues and we're, you know, duplicating effort and we're wasting time. The extent to which we can come together as a community will be really important. You do not have to be a member of the Learning Health System Interest Group, although you're encouraged to join us in that journey, but you are not required to be a member of the Learning Health System Interest Group to be eligible to win the contest and to submit your entry. So we look forward to hearing from you. I want to thank everybody for your time this morning, and please take care, stay safe, have a warm and happy holiday season, and we'll look forward to hearing from you on your challenges that you're eagerly going to be submitting by January 21st. Thank you so much. Have a great day, everybody.